Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we do come before you, Lord. The great God, King of Kings. None before you, none after. What we just seek to see today, Lord, is the definite of your graceness, the definite parts of your greatness, Lord. And we just ask Holy Spirit, like the title of the message, that for the truth be known in my life, most of the time I walk around as a wise guy, and you would have me walk around as a wise man. And for all of us in this place who that might be the case, we just come to hear from you, Holy Spirit. And like your word says, that we don't want to come to this place, or we might have, but we definitely don't want to leave this place, your house today, still being wise in our own eyes. But you, Holy Spirit, would open our eyes to the truths and the foundational things of your word and the richness of the blessings that come as we sang today when we just trust and obey. Because all of your word and all of the things that you have boil down to those things. And we just ask that you would just move in our hearts, our minds, and maybe even as we're done today, rearrange our thoughts, rearrange our speaking, rearrange our seeing and our hearing. And we just ask it in your precious name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
In his book, Literary Lapses, author Stephen Leacock writes, "Many a man in love with a dimple makes the mistake of mirroring the whole girl." Amen. Amen. We see the dimple, we see the smile, and that's the one for me. Then we get married, and oh my. It ain't about the dimple. It ain't about the smile, right? It's about everything that those people are. Our wife, our spouse, the person who we fall in love with. You know, but we live in a time when superficiality, the things that are on the outside, the exteriors, become the most important. If you look right, talk right, act right, you got to be right. No. Because we can all pull that off for a little while. I mean, I can act right and talk right and look real right for about 5 minutes. Right? You know. So, amen. When I first met Tina, I didn't know the Lord. And I was a real wise guy. I mean, I was like a wise guy. And Tina kind of thought, this guy's pretty funny. This guy's hilarious, as a matter of fact. That was my dimple. Then we got married. And it wasn't funny for a lot of years. No, seriously. That the wise guy was ruining everything. Everything. And until, even after I became a believer, I was a believer for a long time superficially. I was confessing God, all that, but I wasn't possessing the things that God really had for me on the inside. But praise God, that all changed. And guess what? My honey, she thinks I'm pretty funny again, right? Okay? If we latch on to the superficial and if we latch on to the external, there's not going to be any foundation there when the tough times come. But in the foundations that God has for us, we will find wisdom. And we will find the things that no matter what happens, the wisdom of God will get us through the things that life has for us. Amen?
Amen.
It says, in this day and age, many a person loves the superficial parts of God. He's love. He is, right? Oh, he's peace, or he's kind. He is. But that's the super part of the superficial vision of what people want to see about God. They want the superficial part of God. They don't want to know any more than, oh, God is love. Well, because God is love, there's things that happen. There's things we are accountable for. There are things we must do. Is he kind? Absolutely. Do the things that God needs you to do. Obey what he has you. He's a very kind God. You go on the other side and you will find that God is a just God and a righteous God, right? But when you get to that point, there's a whole lot of people, the superficiality is all they want, okay? There'll be people who will tell you what they think of God. There'll be people who tell you what they feel about God. There'll be people who tell you what they think God should do. But that's not our place. One author writes, wisdom is to see life from God's point of view. And I don't know again, but I think there's, speaking for myself, a whole lot of times I walk around the 24/7s of my life looking at what God I think should be doing, what it should look like, what it should sound like. And God's saying, you know what, Dave, that's not your position. Your position is to see the life you're living through my point of view.
Amen.
My point of view. It'll change a whole lot of stuff if I look at life through God's point of view. Because if I'm looking at God's life from his point of view, then I'm going to start hearing differently. I'm going to start seeing differently. I'm going to start speaking differently. Instead of moving from that wise guy to the wise man, I will take that second and say, how would the Lord want me to speak right now? When would God rather have me listen than talk? When would he have me stay still instead of act? Right? One author writes, never miss an opportunity to keep your mouth shut. Right? And even as Christians, as believers, we are so far from that. The first thing we want to do is, here's what I can, let me tell you. Here's, just follow my plan. Do this, do that, eat this, don't read that. And where's God in all of this? If we do have an opportunity in situations like that, let's make sure that we do, when we speak, make sure that something's going to do something to elevate somebody, to encourage somebody in the Word of God.
Amen?
Because basically, what is wisdom? Really, to truly know God and to truly trust God. That's what Solomon says in Ecclesiastes. What's the fullness of all of it? Know God and obey him. If we can just do those, right? All the stuff in the middle will take care of itself. Amen? So what we're going to do, and what we're going to do is we're going to open our Bibles. I'm going to give you some verses because we're going to be traveling all around, okay? Here's where we're going to go. So what we're going to do is we're going to open our Bibles to see what God's true wisdom says, our sure foundation, okay? There is no surer foundation than the Word of God. We all agree on that? Okay, so write these down because you're going to need them. Proverbs 3, 25 and 26. Then we're done with 25 and 26. We're going to scoot up to verse 24. We're going to look at Proverbs 10, 22, Proverbs 29, 5, Psalm 14, 1. Okay, where are we at? Okay, from Psalm 14:1, we're going to go to Proverbs 1:7. 1:7, okay? So let's remember, it's we're going to go, okay, Proverbs 3. Because to understand why foundations are so important, we have to grasp why this is the foundation of all that we do and believe, okay? Real quick, this was a poll that was taken. It came out of Answers in Genesis. Okay, millennials, 20-year-olds, okay, 20 to 30. 40% say they are not born again, okay? 35% declare the Bible has errors, or they don't know if it has errors. It's sad. 45% say that Sunday school did not teach them to defend their faith. Okay. 45% say homosexual behavior is not a sin or that they don't know if it's a sin. 40% say gay couples should be allowed to marry. 20% say there are books other than the Bible that are inspired by God. And 65% believe that if you're a good person, you will go to heaven. Okay? The problem with that is, chiefly, is it has nothing to do with this. And the people that they did this poll is, they go to church 3 out of 4 Sundays a month. 3 out of 4 Sundays. So what that means is if we took a poll in the church at large, this would be the findings. So I don't know where, if it's a problem with me or Pastor Rick or the Sunday school teachers, but like Elder Renee and I were talking when just before services started, there's only so much I can do. There's only so much Pastor Rick can do. There's only so much elders can do. There's only so much anybody can do. The only way that we individually come to understand the foundational truths of God is individually get into God's word.
Amen.
There is no other way. I can stand up here 24/7. You could put a loop of Pastor Rick up here from every message he's preached for 45 years, and we'll walk out of here for the most part the same as when we walked in. I have to understand. I want to, like Proverbs says, I have to dig for wisdom like a miner for gold. Anybody ever seen a clean, unsweaty miner? No, seriously. Anybody ever seen anybody come out of a mine that ain't dirty and sweaty? You have got to dig for the riches that you want. You don't just open this book and go, hey, that, and then put it down and expect through osmosis some of God's wisdom is to enter into our lives. It doesn't work that way. If it worked that way, I'd just put it under my head at night and go to sleep and wake up in the morning. No. This has to be the most precious thing in your life.
Amen.
Christ saves us. He died for us, and he did what? He left us this so that we would know now what to do after he went back to heaven and wait for his return. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Let me get to Proverbs 3. These are foundationals. Okay. Foundationals meaning if we go by them, if we trust God for what we're reading and what he's saying. You there? Proverbs 3, 25 and 26. Do not be afraid of sudden terror. What is sudden terror? That's life. That's what we're living. Sudden terror is what we wake up and then we go to bed. In between the wake up and go to bed and even while we're sleeping, we don't know what's going to happen. Like we were praying, those people in France, when they woke up that morning, they did not think that a bunch of ISIS people were going to grenade them, blow themselves up, and machine gun them. But what God's word is telling us foundationally is we are not to be afraid of that. We wake up in the morning, and whatever is built in it, what does God say? Do not be afraid of the sudden terror. John says that what? True love casts out what? Fear. Fear. If we are truly in love with God because we know he is truly in love with us, what part of the 24/7s does he not have control of? But if I keep being wise in my own eyes, I will not see what God has for me. The blessings and the protection. Right? Do not be afraid. If you feel like it, be afraid. Sometimes this thing might happen and be afraid. No, do not be afraid of sudden terror, nor of trouble of the wicked when it comes. We don't, as we stand here, we don't have to worry about Christ's second coming. Amen? Do you understand that? Everybody in this room who is truly born again, who is righteous with God, has no fear of Christ's return. We should be praying for Christ's return. We don't have to worry one iota of that which is coming on those who are of the wicked. That's not our plot. That's not our lot because of what Christ has done for us and what we've accepted. Amen. So, for a raise of hands, how many people in here in some way or another are afraid of something? Yay! Okay? That's the natural reality of it. Christ says, now what? Whatever that thing is that you just raised your hand about, why don't you let God take care of that? Why don't you let Him draw that from you right now? That's why we're here. That's what He does. Look at verse 26. For the Lord will be your confidence. What are we all putting confidence in? Linebackers? Big linemen? Yeah. 250-pound centers? You know, 95-mile-an-hour fastball? Right? Bank accounts, whatever it is. Right? We cannot let those things be our confidence. The Lord will be your confidence. Dr. Benson wrote that confidence is a sufficient and sure ground.
Amen.
Sufficient means it's all you need, and sure meaning it's not going anywhere. And will keep your foot from being caught. Caught in the things that the ungodly are caught in because we are walking in the ways of God. Most of the things that I get caught in, most of the things that you get caught in are self-inflicted. You get caught in the things that you do that you know you shouldn't do, and then when you get caught, you go, what happened? Amen. Renee's going, amen. Amen. Every self-inflicted caught is self-inflicted. God says, let me direct your paths. Right? If I let God direct my paths, guess what? All them self-inflicted things do what? Now, there's things of life. Like you said, we're not supposed to fear the things that are near. That doesn't mean that we live in a fallen world. But I can do a whole lot in my own life to keep me out of those pits that I keep falling in. The Holy Spirit's like one of big neon arrows. Like you want to go get a burger. It's like, burger, like this. It's just that neon, just, right? It's the same thing. The Holy Spirit is where? He's in us. He's also what? Omnipresent. He knows the pit over there. He knows there's a big pothole. You know, you're driving on the freeboom 75, all of a sudden there's a pothole. Boom, boom, boom. You know, you're driving down Tustin, Chapman. They're everywhere. Right? The Holy Spirit to us, in us, is you're going down life 24/7. Pothole, pothole, horseman. Don't go there, don't go there. Go around, detour. Crash. He can tell us to turn. He can tell us to stop. But unless I turn and stop, crash. Every time. Amen. Look at it. Was go kind of now. Go back to 24. If you adhere to 25 and 26, look what happens in 24. When you lie down, you will not be afraid. Yes. You will lie down, and your sleep will be sweet. Amen? Well, you don't know my situation, Pastor Dave. No. You really don't know how I've been getting hammered. No. God knows. He says if we do the things that He says to do, trust and obey, and know that He's in control, when we lay down at night, guess what? We're going to sleep and sleep sweetly. Amen.
Amen.
Go to Proverbs 10:24. I'm sorry, 10:22. If I said 10:24, I meant 10:22. So the Lord, He's our confidence, right? He's our sufficient and sure ground. Proverbs 10:22, the blessing of the Lord makes me rich.
Wow.
The blessing of the Lord makes me rich. Now, the blessing of the Lord won't pay my rent.
Yeah.
You sure? Rich means, okay, it doesn't, like, Tina's got, you know, customers with Bentleys and Ferraris and cars in their garages. We don't even know what they are. Don't even know. She'll come and say, this guy just bought a new car. It doesn't even have a label. I can't even tell you what it is. Okay? In this life, that's considered riches. Pastor Rick just got done teaching through Philippians what Paul says what? Whether hungry, whether full, whether cold, whether warm, whether naked, whether clothed, I have that learned that secret of contentment. We might not think we have everything that we need, but what we have to understand is when we get this new thinking is what we have is everything that we need now. Now, you don't know my situation. I don't. But we're all here, it seems like, week after week, and everything seems to be going as it needs to go. We eat, we sleep, we do what we do. The thing is, we have to have a juxtaposition here. I might not think myself rich. Bring someone here from the Sudan. Bring someone here from places that would make us not understand how people live. I remember years and years ago, we had a Bible study in our house, and someone brought a DVD, which is tells you how long ago, because I don't know if they even have DVDs anymore, but it was about the all that was going on in the Sudan. And there were these folks that they were getting butchered. They were, people were, just like it's happening now, they were chopping off their limbs. If they were Christians, they were just mutilating these guys. Kids, it didn't matter. And at the end of this DVD, there was this group of young people, teenagers, and they were singing praise songs, and they didn't have hands, but they were clapping their stumps. Just there was no hands, and they were smiling, and they were clapping and singing praises to God. That is a rich person. That is a rich person. If that happened to me, I don't know. I would hope that I would take whatever God has left with me, and I would clap it together and sing his praises. I don't know if I like that definition of rich. Get used to it. Get used to it, folks. Because if not, sometimes you study, you're reading things. He says, this one author puts, and we have to get this as Christians, satisfaction starts when comparisons stop.
Yes, yes.
Amen? As believers. Satisfaction will start in my life when comparisons stop in my life. Max Lucado had a story one time. He said, you got these two guys, and they're carrying bags of rocks. And he said, the worst thing you ever want to do is look in somebody else's bag of rocks. Because one has more than you, and one has less than you, and you never know what that man's carrying and why, so don't ask for his bag of rocks. Be content and carry the bag of rock that God has given you. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. And at the end of that it says, but fools die for the lack of wisdom. Nope. That was the wrong one. And he adds sorrow with it. You ever notice the people with the Ferraris? Tina can tell you. Some of these people are the saddest. They've got more than you can even understand, and they just, there is no peace with it. You can give, and you can live, and you can travel, and you can get all the stuff and add to it, but everything you get that's not of God will have a sorrow attached. How do I keep it? How do I lose it? I don't want to lose it. Look where it just went. So I did, you know, look at Carl. They just did, somebody broke his, took his computer, laptop. That makes you mad. You don't like that violation. Okay? But what happens? He wasn't depending on it. If you depend on the riches of man, you are going to be always in sorrow of losing what man gives.
Amen.
Amen. Okay, we're going to go to Proverbs 29:25. And then we're going to get... Amen? We're there? Twenty-nine, 25. Okay? The fear of man brings a snare, but whoever trusts in the Lord shall be safe.
Amen.
Fear of man brings a snare. Why? Because you're always worried about what this man, whoever it is, can do, can't do, take from you, give you. Right? Like they say, for every right you get, for everything the government gives you as far as rights, guess what? The government can take them away. But whoever trusts in the Lord shall be safe. What does the writer of Hebrews say in 13:6? The Lord, right? God is my helper. God is my helper. I shall not fear, for what can man do to me? Seriously, these are the foundational things. What did Jesus say in his own words? Hey, don't trust the guy who can kill you. That's all he can do. You're dead. But you better fear the one who, after he kills you, can commit your soul to hell. That's who you fear.
Amen.
That's what Paul said in 1 Thessalonians. I'm not here to please man. I don't care what man thinks of what I preach, what I do. My job is to what? Please God, because he tests my heart.
Amen.
He knows my motives. Amen? So, I mean, we're here as believers and non-believers. We are here, don't get me wrong, we're here to treat each other as brothers and sisters. We are here to treat each other outside of this place, just like the Lord said in Genesis 1. We are all created in the image and likeness of God. You know, and it just strikes me, you know, Black Lives Matter, Italian Lives Matter, all these lives matter. And it's, you know, guess what? The book says we are all created in the image and likeness of God. If we started saying, look, brothers and sisters and whatever, I don't know, Chinese and Italians and whatever, we are all created in the image and likeness of God. You know what that makes us all? Absolutely equal. Equal. Paul writes in the 17th act, chapter of Acts, we are all from one blood. Don't people understand that? The foolishness of man says we can make laws, we can do this, we can write things and say things and make people like each other. It's never going to happen. It's never going to happen. But once we instill in people the understanding that we are all created in the image and likeness of God, then guess what happens? There's going to be a mutual respect for one another. It doesn't matter. When we look at each other, all we see is a creation of God. All, guess what? You trace this all back? I don't care if your family's from Palermo. I don't care if you're from where you're from, Bunyard. I don't care. Sooner or later, somewhere, wherever them Tigris, Euphrates, and the Gishon and all them things came together, mom and dad were there. Long, long time ago. That's where the original mom and dad were. So, amen? All right. So let's go to Psalms 1 or Psalm 14:1 real quick. So we all got that? That's foundational. Be blessed by God. Have confidence in God. Trust God. Our safety is in God. The things that we need, God will bring to us. We don't have to fear. And when we're walking in God's ways, when we're trusting and obeying, guess what? When we lay down at night, if we are truly doing these things, our sleep will be sweet. Amen? And if it's not, if something is different than that, then guess what? I don't check this. I check this. There's nothing happening here that's not right. That's not eternal. That's not from God. If there's anything different happening opposite of this, it's me. It's me. And the difference between a wise man and a wise guy, the wise man will admit when it's me. The wise guy will always be you. You know, I had to eat oatmeal 6 times a day when I was a kid. All of this stuff. No. That's fine, but you get to the point where the book of James says, this is a mirror. And I look into this mirror, and I see the things that God wants me to see. And if I walk away from that, looking like everything's fine, I don't have a zit here, and I cut myself shaving here, then guess what? I'm not being honest to the standard of God. Amen? Psalm 14:1. Let Dave get here. Okay. Psalm 14:1. Now, that's why you had to lay the foundation, because if you go to this, you have to see why. A fool has said in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt. They have done abominable works. There is none who does good. Sounds like Romans 3. Okay, there's none righteous, not one. The fool has said. The word for fool there is Nabal. Just like Nabal in 1 Samuel 25. In Scripture, if you read that, says he's a dense, harsh man. And right after that, though, Abigail was of great understanding and very nice to look at. Paraphrase. Okay? So it says that he was a fool. He was Nabal. Basically, that means dense, ignorant, morally, intellectually, and spiritually. And such as we all were, and like I said, given any part of the day, as we still are. Remember in, I think it's Mark 7, when they're in the boat, and they're talking about, you know, the yeast of the Pharisees and the bread, and the disciples are talking about one thing, and the Lord turns to them and says, how much understanding do you guys have? And how much longer do I got to hang out with you guys? And if you look at the NIV, the Lord asks them, how dull are you? Anybody got the NIV? Okay. Go to Mark 7. I think it's 7:18. Mark 7, 18, verse 18. Okay. Yeah, verse 7:18. So they're talking about what's clean and unclean. They've gone through that whole thing with the Pharisees, what goes in, what comes out, and all of this stuff, right? In verse 17, he says, when he had entered the house away from the crowd, his disciples asked him concerning the parable. Verse 18. So he said to them, are you thus without understanding? Do you not perceive whatever enters a man from the outside cannot defile him? And if you read that in the NIV, he asks him, are you so dull, dense, right? In the Hebrew, it means thick-brained. No, that's what Nabal means. It's thick-brained, all right, when we get there. So he's saying it in 14:1, a fool in his heart. So there is no God. And the problem with that is you have to have the attributes that God has to be able to say that there is no God. First of all, you have to be omnipresent. You'd have to be able to be in all places at all times at the same time to know that there is no God. And you have to be omniscient. You'd have to know beyond my boundaries somewhere, and anywhere there is something to be known, I know it. But that's what he's saying. Okay? Which doesn't work. So a fool in his heart says there is no God. But that's the wise guy. What does the wise man say? We know in our heart. We have come to know, truly know, that God exists. And he loves us. And he is the God who he says he is. Right? Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God. God did it like that. That's the first words of the five books of Moses, of the law. Why? Why are you going to follow? What would be the purpose? Why are you going to follow someone, a God, who isn't responsible for everything? If I created it and I sustain it and I do all these things, then guess what? You better listen. In the beginning, God created. Not in the beginning, Muhammad created. Not in the Confucius or all these other people. Joseph Smith. In the beginning, God. I'm going to tell you that right off the bat, first thing, so that when I tell you what you need to do, what you need to believe, and what you need to trust, you're going to know that I'm the God who can do that. I mean, in the beginning, folks, in the beginning, God. So from that in the beginning to everything that was made, from everything that was unseen till now and into eternity, God is God. If he says, I'll protect you, I'll protect you. If he says you can stand on the sure, sufficient ground, stand on it. If you will be blessed and sleep sweetly, if you follow me, you will sleep and be blessed and you will dream and sleep sweetly. Yes or no? Thank you. Okay. Because God is the God of everything and everything that needs to be done, then, now, present, and future. Amen. Okay? So let's go to Proverbs 1:7. Proverbs 1:7. Amen? Yeah. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Fear. The word in the Hebrew is yirah. And it could be, and he goes, well, it's a reverent awe. It is. But you have to understand, it's a dread in Deuteronomy 1:29. It means dread. Dread. You know what dread means? Dread. Okay? It's being terrified in Jonah 1:10, right? But it means also standing and on 1 Kings 3:28. Yeah. And, excuse me, having, I can't read my own writing. Oh, having reverence in Leviticus 19:3, okay? So it's all of those things. And it's that tension between that understanding of the dread and the terror and of the lovingness and the reverence. We draw from both, right? We understand his fear, but understanding who he is draws us near. It isn't that trembling, shaking that keeps us away. It's the understanding of who he is and what he is that brings us near. So it says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Why? Because it is actually the word beginning is the first thing, the chief thing. If we don't understand who God is first and chiefly, nothing else matters, friends. Do you understand? There is no wisdom, there is no riches, there's nothing that we're chasing after if we don't understand who God is matters. Because if we sit here today, as we are in this place, the only thing that matters is to know God as who he is, that he sent his son to die on a cross for us because we are sinners. Not to know that is not to know anything that matters. That's what God's word is saying. Not to know that is not to know anything that matters. I'm a PhD. Do you know that Christ died for your sins and God created all things? No. He might have had the same education I did. Amen. You know, like I said, school was something that interrupted my weekends. Seriously. Seriously. Okay? I don't care, you know, how many letters you got after your name. If you don't know who the true God is and what the true God did for you and for me, you are as unwise as any man walking the earth. Amen. Because it's not what I say. It's what the book says. There is no true wisdom apart from God. There was one author that says, right, know the truth, and the truth will make you mad. No, but that way, we understand? That's what we don't like. We speak the truth, God's truth, and it's know the truth, and most of the time, the truth will make you mad. I don't like that. I'm sorry. Well, I don't, you know, I'll tell you what I think. Tell God what you think. I don't want to hear it. I got not enough time trying to make myself compatible by the power of the Holy Spirit to what this book says, right? I think God should do this. Well, talk to him. Here's what I think. Here's what I'm sorry. We only have so much time. You know, C.S. Lewis says that we should spend less time defending truth and more time feeding on the truth. Not that we're not called to defend it, but it says sometimes we spend more time defending what we think is true, right, than feeding on what is true. But fools despise wisdom and instruction. Avail is that word for fool. In Psalm 1, verse 14:1, it was just someone who was ignorant of the word. This fool is the one who was arrogant and flippant. It's not that they don't know. This is the man who arrogantly and flippantly says, so what? I'll take my chances. I'll flip a coin. Well, okay. You can believe that, but there's a time coming when the arrogance and the ignorance won't be any, what is it, when you stand before God? Here's, okay, go to Romans 10 real quick and we'll see. Romans 10, 1 through 3, and if somebody wants to go to 1 Timothy 1:13. I'll get to Romans because it's basically the same. Romans, okay, I'm at Romans 10. 1 Timothy 1, it's basically 10 to 13. Romans 10, 1 to 3. Brethren, Paul speaking, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they may be saved. Okay, we're talking a nation now. For I bear them witness that they have zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. Right? They had a zeal for the law, they had a zeal for the written thing, but they didn't have a zeal for the true knowledge of who God was, who Messiah was. Okay? Verse 3. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted to the righteousness of God. Okay? And then, okay, remember that word, ignorant. It's anoeo in the Greek. So we'll go to Timothy. Okay, 1 Timothy 1. Actually, okay, verse 12. And I thank Christ Jesus our Lord who has enabled me because of his, counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry. Verse 13, although I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, and insolent, verse 4, insolent man, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly out of unbelief. Ah, noeo. Right? So what that means, ah negates, and noeo means to recognize. It means the nation of Israel didn't recognize Messiah, and Paul didn't, ah noeo, he didn't recognize Christ until he got slapped down in Acts 9 on the road to Damascus. Then the ah noeo went around and goes, what would you like, Lord? But the thing is, ignorance does not have anything to do with not being culpable for what we do. You're not going to get to God's throne and say, I was ignorant. He's going to say, too bad. Right? Because Romans says there is no excuse. Walk out at night and go, infinite time and chance, a couple 20 billion years. No. No. And our conscience dictates that there has to be something transcendent from us. Okay? So, back to Proverbs 1:7. So it says that the person, right? But the fools despise wisdom. It means has contempt. And they just don't despise the wisdom, they don't want instruction. They don't want to hear that something's wrong. They don't want to hear that they might need Jesus. They don't want to hear that something they're doing may not be good for them or good for their family or any. And they just don't want to hear it because, you know what? I know better. I know better than what you have to say, and I got to make sure when I am speaking that I'm speaking the truths of God's words. Amen? Amen. Amen. Okay, so let's go real quick. I think for me, what I notice most, because I think what most people notice most are words, because most of us are like talking all the time, whether it makes sense or not. We just like to hear ourselves, like, okay? So let's go to Proverbs 18:21 and see what God's word says about words. The weight, what we have to understand is the weight of our words, W-E-I-G-H-T. We there? 18:21. Death and life are in the power of the tongue. We read that, and I think we just kind of either gloss over. Sometimes we want to take, like Joshua, meditate on the word. That continually under the breath mumbling and speaking of what God's word says. We have to understand God's word saying death, and death in the Hebrew means ruin. Ruin. Ruin and life. Life in Hebrew means living things. When we speak as Christians, and when we speak and or otherwise, the things we are speaking are going to do two things. They are going to speak ruin into someone's life. We are going to speak so negatively that the things that they're hearing will crush their spirits. We have to understand how powerful words are. And the Word of God is making us understand how important words are. What we speak, when we speak, I have to take that second like we prayed earlier and have God's mind. Galatians 5:6 says we are to walk in the Spirit, right? Galatians 5:6, walk in the Spirit. I don't have to just walk in the Spirit. I need to think in the Spirit, speak in the Spirit, listen in the Spirit. It all has to be done in the Spirit, or whenever I walk or talk or speak, it's going to be just gibberish. If I'm walking in the Spirit, I have to hear or speak or think in that same Spirit. Or else what happens from that? When I speak, I'll be speaking ruin. I don't have that right. Did Christ speak ruin? No. No. What gives me the right to speak so evilly or meanly to someone? But I am to speak living things. I am to speak life. Does not mean we don't address the things that are wrong. That doesn't mean you just forget about it, sweep it under the rug. There's a way to speak. And those who love it shall eat its fruit. And I understand that. Because I eat the negative fruit of a ruinous tongue for a long time. And I understand the fruits of a ruinous tongue. It's true that what you speak to the ruination or the life-giving life that you can speak to someone is true. It's true. Go to Proverbs 19:18. We'll maybe do one or two more, but we're going to 19:18. When you're there, say amen. 19:18. And this is the one that hit really close to home, and maybe close to home for a majority of us or some of us. Chasten your son while there is hope. We are to discipline our sons, yes. And while there is hope, before the ways of wrong are so set in their lives that the discipline won't matter anymore. And do not set your heart on his destruction. When you speak, you make sure that why you're speaking and how you're speaking is life-giving. Because if not, you can come very, very, very close. Not to just destroying the person, but destroying every hope of a relationship for as long as those two people exist. And I'm going to tell you that God's grace is so great, that even in a ruinous attitude of malicious talking for years and years. God is so good in his, what he says is true. That this last Saturday, our oldest son called me and his brother and his friend, and we went over there to see Nitro Circus at the pond. And you really won't know how important that was. And I called him. I said, Matt, you will never know, even in words, how important it was that you called and invited me to that event. Because God can take ruinous language, words of death, and heal that and bring it to life in our spirits. Amen?
Amen.
So we have to understand, when we talk, the power that our words carry. We have to. One more. Let's look at Proverbs 18:22. This was another thing that Hallelujah. Proverbs 18:22. And then we're going to close. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. We there?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Proverbs 18:22. My words will be ruinous, or my words will be life-giving. But how I look at my wife, how I view my wife, will make every difference in my household, for those who come in, whether friends, family, or strangers. Amen?
Amen.
Proverbs 18:22. He who finds a wife finds a good thing.
Amen.
Amen. No, hey. Hallelujah. But here's what we have to... The word find is in the causative tense. It's a causative word, meaning if you are seeking, you will be finding. Am I seeking a good wife? Am I seeking this gift from God? Regardless of all the stuff that goes on the inside and outside, and if you only knew, am I seeking a good wife? Because if I'm seeking a good wife, I will find a good wife. I will find a good wife. And it says, amen. And look, and obtain favor from the Lord. Guess what? In Proverbs, I think it's 31, you find a good wife, it's better than rubies. Look, friends in our families, am I seeking rubies in my house? Am I seeking rubies with my wife? Or am I searching for some rhinestones? Am I searchingly affecting something? Guess what? If I'm looking for the counterfeit, if I'm looking for the bad, I'm going to find it.
Amen.
Well, you don't know. My wife, here's the thing about having, when you're a pastor and you're preaching and your wife is sitting here, don't ask me. Ask her. And she will gladly, without pulling any punches, tell you what went on in our house. And praise God, I hope she would, because what was isn't what is.
Amen.
Isn't what is. Amen?
Amen.
So we're gonna close. Friends, trust God. Trust Him and be blessed. Stand on that sufficient, sure ground. When I speak, let my heart first be turned to giving life. Giving life. And like the author said, if I'm ready to talk and it doesn't make sense, don't pass up the opportunity to be quiet.
Yes.
To be quiet. And in our families, when we go home and we shut the door behind us, I will find what I'm truly looking for.
Amen.
Do I want rubies in a house? Do I want a house that's built with knowledge and understanding and all the rooms filled with precious things?
Yes.
If I'm seeking that and working to that, I'll find that.
Amen.
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 Amen. My pleasure.